afternoon, everyone. Welcome to 5759 Optimization for Static and Dynamic Systems Class. I hope everyone has this course information So I think there are about 40 or so registered students for in-person and about 10-15 registered for online asynchronous section of this class. So in order to facilitate the, well, I have been recording my lecture videos for the past 4 or so years, and I upload them all to YouTube. So my last 4 years of optimization lectures are all on YouTube. You can go and watch them. So the video quality for 2020 videos are the best, because that was done on, I mean, the entire course was on tablet because it was online. So that video quality is very good, but I'm still going to record these lectures for people who are doing online asynchronous version of this class, and I'm going to be writing on blackboard. So in case, you know, you catch COVID or something and you have to be online for several days or weeks, it's completely fine, because all these lectures are going to be recorded and uploaded to YouTube. You see the camera, the jumbo camera right there, that's recording the lecture. Okay, any questions? No? So prerequisites for this class, 3050, I know that 3551 is written as prerequisite officially on the website, but the fact is I have removed that as prerequisite, and 3050 is a prerequisite for this class. So if you have taken 3050, or in other words, if you are mathematically mature, if you understand what proofs mean and what theorems mean and how do you go about proving things, you should be good for this class. We are of course not going to cover proofs of optimization, proof of convergence of optimization algorithms, but we will cover a lot of theorems in this class, and perhaps one or two proofs in this class. Linear algebra is a strong prerequisite for this class. People who have struggled in this class are not well equipped to understand linear algebra, do not have a good grasp on linear algebra tools and techniques. Eigenvalues, eigenvectors, rank of a matrix, inverse of a matrix, all of these things are something that should come naturally to you. If it doesn't, you will struggle in this class, and I apologize for it, but this is an optimization algorithms class. So you have to be extremely comfortable with linear algebra. You have to know MATLAB programming. There will be a few assignments that will require you to code in MATLAB. You can of course choose to use Python. MATLAB is not the only programming language that one can use. So if you want to use Python, that's completely fine with me. If you want to use MATLAB, that's completely fine with me. Just do the assignment and submit the plots. Okay, that's what I care about. And if something goes wrong in your plots, then I will look at your code. Well, not I, but the TA will look at your code. Since you're all here, you kind of know what the time in classroom is, which is good. The office hours are going to be Friday 3 to 4 p.m. right after the class. You could also meet me on Zoom. So you can either stay back after the class, talk to me here. You can come to my office after this class on Friday. Or you could just meet me on Zoom on Friday. Or you could send me an appointment for any other time of the week if you want to meet me. My availability, my calendar is on the Carmen Canvas page. So you can go there. There is an instructor calendar link. You can look at my calendar and send me a meeting invite for any time of the day. Except like after 9 a.m. I can't do any meeting between 8 to 9 a.m. I'm not a morning person. The TA for the course is Aarti Vedula. For the time being, she is going to be grading the assignments, and maybe answering homework questions if you have any. I would strongly suggest you come to me for homework questions. But if I'm unavailable, say because I'm going for a conference or whatever, then you can talk to her about the questions on the homework. The course text is Nonlinear Programming by Dmitry Bertsikas. This is the book. This is what it looks like. This is the third edition. The second edition is also fine. You don't have to have the book. The book is a good reference book for everything related to optimization or for everything related to nonlinear programming. So if you are going to make a career in optimization, this is the book to have. If you're not going to make a career in optimization and this is just a course requirement for your master's or PhD degree, you don't need to buy the book. It's an expensive book to buy. Evaluation policy, there will be 6 homeworks, 3 online time quizzes, 2 take-home midterms, and 1 project. The take-home midterms will be 1 hour long, so I'm going to implicitly assume, so because this class is split into in-person and online, I'm going to have a take-home midterm, otherwise it would be an in-class midterm. An in-class midterm means you only have 55 minutes to write the solution, so your take-home midterm will be exactly that long, which means you will get an entire day, but you should be able to do the entire midterm within 55 minutes. The way I set my midterm papers is I give myself 1/5 of the time that is allocated to you for doing the exam. So if you get 55 minutes to do the exam, I get only 11 minutes to complete the exam. Okay, that's my criteria. So you can imagine how long the midterm is going to be. So there are 2 take-home midterms, 3 online time quizzes. The online time quizzes are such that you can take at most 3 attempts, you can make at most 3 attempts, and the highest of the 3 attempts will be considered your final grade for the quiz. The goal for the quiz is not to test your understanding, but to nail in you what are the important concepts so that you remember it for the rest of your life. Okay, so mostly people will have 10 out of 10 on all the quizzes, and that's because it gets nailed into your head after the 3 attempts, what is the right answer for every question. The homeworks are very challenging, so I would expect you to work in groups, and if you have any questions, definitely come to me. If you go to ratemyprofessor.com, people have written bad things about my homework. You know, I'm paid to make your life miserable, what can I do? Homework policy, you know, you can again take help from your fellow students, and come to me if you have any questions, there's no problem with that. The first midterm is going to be on October 13th. The second midterm is going to be on November 12th. And there will be no classes on these 2 days because you will be doing your midterm. And it is expected that you will do it during the class time, but of course you are free to do it anytime during the day. There are no final exams. Your project is essentially your final exam. The project report is due on December 6th. Which is towards the end of the class. It should be a 5 plus page report on whatever topic you have chosen for project. There are a few potential project topics that are listed in the handout that I've shared with you. So you can go over the possible project topics and you can pick one that is appropriate for your future interest. There are a lot of different topics that we will cover in this class, starting from gradient methods and convergence properties to optimization over convex set, constraint optimization, Lagrange multiplier theorem, and KP theorem, and duality and convex programming. Lot of fun stuff. Like I mentioned, I'm not going to cover the proofs of most of the results, but I will tell you what the theorems are so that you understand why the algorithms that I'm describing in the class, why do they converge? Okay, so at least you will have some sense of what exactly is happening in this high dimensional spaces and how are they converging to the optimal solution. The most important thing is project report in this class. So, you know, optimization is a very broad and foundational topic. So no matter which field you go to, whether you're going to autonomous car company or whether you're going to Cisco, or whether you're going to Google, or whether you're going to Amazon, or some other company, Ford, or GM, or Chrysler, you have to know optimization as long as you are within their optimization group. And it has just too many applications, and I just cannot cover, there is just no way for me to cover those applications in the classroom. So project is a way for you to explore the field of interest wherever you want to go. Let's say somebody wants to go to a supply chain company, they can do project on optimization as applied to supply chain. One person was from civil engineering, and in maybe like 3 or 4 years ago, he was from civil engineering, he took this class. He did detection of water leakage in a water network. I wouldn't even imagine that optimization could be applied in that particular application, but apparently it can. You can detect sewage leakage or water leakage from pipelines using techniques from optimization. So it's just a way for you to explore your interest, see how optimization gets applied, perhaps write a project report, not perhaps, you have to write a project report about it. And through this exercise, you can, so what you will do is when you write your resume, you can write that in your resume as a block that, oh, I did some project which applied optimization techniques to blah, blah, blah. And that could help you get a interview or whatever in whatever company you want to go. So I have had quite a lot of conversations with General Electric GE and Ford and BorgWarner and Google people and Microsoft people and so on. And optimization gets used everywhere. And so my hope is that when you do the project and you write about it, it could help you get an interview in those companies.
Do you have any advice for people who are pursuing a PhD and want to join
engineering after that? Oh. You can talk to me offline about it. So if you want to go to academia, you can, I mean, you have to do some very theoretical optimization project. I think that would be more appropriate. There is a whole page on office hours and Zoom information, which you can use for your reading pleasure. I'm not going to be streaming the class online on Zoom, so the Zoom link is only for office hours. So if you want to meet me during some office hours, or you know, if you want to have an individual meeting, you can just use this Zoom link for meeting me. Next comes EC diversity and anti-racism statement. The Electrical and Computer Engineering Department, as well as the university, promotes diversity and would like all of you to respect other people's opinions, other people's cultures, ethnicities, backgrounds. You know, you shouldn't discriminate on that basis. And you should, EC faculty and staff aspire to hear voices of those disenfranchised by racism. So I hope that you guys will look at these statements and will imbibe these values for your future. There are ample number of counseling and consultation services, so if you're facing stress, if you're facing mental health problems, there are opportunities for you to express them and get professional help from trained people using some of the numbers that are written there in the paper. You must follow all the health and safety guidelines from the Ohio State University and from the City of Columbus. You will be, I mean, non-compliance will be warned first and disciplinary actions will be taken if for repeated offenses. You all have carbon access, I'm sure you are all experts on carbon now. You will be able to access most of the course material on carbon. All the assignments and quizzes and all that stuff will happen through carbon, so you should be familiar with that. If you have any issues with accessing MATLAB on computer and stuff, you can get some help from servicedesk@osc.edu, and they can help you with some of the installation, software installation for MATLAB. Or if you don't have the license, how do you get the license and all that stuff, you can find the help on OCIO website. Any material you use in the classwork, you should provide appropriate copyright disclaimer with that. And this is particularly true for project reports. You know, your answers will of course be yours, so there is no copyright disclaimer there. But if you're if you're doing a project and you've picked up some theory, something from some other paper or resource, you should definitely cite those papers and resources. It's just a good habit to inculcate for your future. If you have a disability, please register yourself with SMDF, and if you need any accommodations, we'll be very happy to support you in order to carry out your academic program. You are required to adhere to the student code of conduct, and if you are found in violation for student code of conduct, then strict actions will be taken against you. The most important thing is write your own solutions. Do not copy it from other people. Write your own codes. Do not copy it from other people. That's what the entire spirit of student code of conduct is. Do not copy. Okay. So as long as you understand, do not copy, you are pretty much adhering to the student code of conduct. If you have been so statement on Title IX, which is actually very important. So if you think you have been discriminated on the basis of sex or gender, or you have faced harassment, the university will provide appropriate measures for you to carry out your academic curriculum. And in order to get help, you need to email title9@osc.edu. If I get a sense that you or someone you know has been harassed, discriminated against on the basis of your sex or gender, if you have been sexually harassed or are in relationship violence, I'm supposed to report these things to title9@osc.edu. So I will do that if in case I get that feeling by talking to you. Your mental health is important to us. And if you are facing any mental health issues, there are ample opportunities within the university for you to find help and professional guidance. So please use these facilities if in case you find yourself in suffering from any mental anxiety or stress or mental health issues. Food assistance. So now it is extremely, it's common for students to simply sustain yourself on cheap and unhealthy food, and that's wrong. You should eat healthy food. And therefore, OSU has the Buckeye Food Alliance and Midwire Food Bank, and they will support students who need access to good food. And please make use of these resources if you find yourself in the unfortunate situation of not being able to afford good food. You have opportunities within OSU to make sure that you don't have any problem in carrying out your study here at OSU. Any questions on the course information? All of this stuff is there in the sheet that I have shared. Anyone who has not received it so far? People who came in late? Anyone else? Multivariate functions, and we'll talk about some eigenvalues, eigenvector stuff, which is part of linear algebra. So we'll talk about all this thing in the next 3 or 4 lectures, and after that we'll jump right into optimization. Once we get into optimization, things are going to be fast and things are going to be crazy. So be ready for the ride. Okay. Norms. So if you have a vector x, so this is Rn, this is the Euclidean space, n-dimensional Euclidean space. This is x, it's a variable, it's a vector in Rn. And the norm satisfies the following 3 properties. The norm is greater than or equal to 0. And norm of x is equal to 0 if and only if x is a 0 vector. This is the definition of the norm. There are 3 properties, so we need to cover all 3 properties. If I multiply vector x by a scalar, then the norm is an appropriately scaled value. So absolute value of A, A is a scalar. So let me write the list of symbols. This is if and only if. This is there exists. This is for all. I guess these are the 3 symbols that I've used pretty often. And the 3rd property is triangular inequality. So if you have a function, or if you have a norm on the vector on the Euclidean space Rn, and it satisfies these 3 properties, then you can call it a norm. The examples of usual norms, L2 norm, which is x norm of x2 is equal to square root x transpose x, which is equal to square root summation inside the I force. That is the famous L2 norm. Component of x, and so you look at the absolute value, take the maximum, that's the L infinity constant. norms useful? Why do we study norms? Why would it be useful in optimization? Any thoughts?
It's a measure of distance.
Right. So it can provide you with a measure to, with a way to measure distance between two points. So that's the metric. So from this norm, you can derive a metric. So the distance between two vectors x and y would be the norm between norm of x minus y. Okay, so that provides you with a way to measure the distance between two points x and y in the space. Why is distance important to optimization?
Yeah. I was actually going to ask a quick question. Is this, when you say distance of x and y, does that refer specifically to the L2 norm of x minus y?
So it could be any norm.
Okay.
Yeah, you could use any norm that whatever is the favorite norm. Now, of course, in optimization, L2 norm is what is generally used, but that's not the only norm, and sometimes it would be appropriate to look at other norms, even within the optimization framework. It's not common, but it is. But sometimes looking at other norms is helpful. Okay. So you can use any norm here. Why do we need to measure distance between two points in optimization?
Because the smallest distance will be an
answer. Sorry?
Smallest distance will be the answer.
Smallest distance would be the answer. Well, yes, in some cases, yes, the distance itself is what you are optimizing, and therefore the smallest distance would be the optimal point. But there's another reason why within algorithms, distance is something that's very important. So let me give you an example. Have you heard someone saying, my algorithm blew up? What does it mean for an algorithm to blow up? Yeah.
So it become unbounded?
Unbounded, right? So things become unbounded. What could be the opposite of blow up?
Convergence.
It converges, right? How do you measure convergence? How do I mean, if I'm looking at xk, so I'm running some optimization algorithm. I start with x0, then I get x1, x2, x3, x4, x5. And I say, hey, look, it's converging. What does it mean for something to converge? Yes?
For the xi is tall, equal each other as I goes on to infinity.
Right, so xi become equal to each other, or in other words, the distance between successive iterates becomes smaller and smaller, right? So I start with x0 minus x1 is 200, but then x1 minus x2 is 10, and then x2 minus x3 is 10 raised to minus 4. So we kind of know that, okay, this thing is converging. My algorithm is converging, I'm getting something which is reasonable. So that's where distance becomes extremely important. And what norm you pick in order to measure the distance is actually a very, very important thing to know. Now, of course, you know, this course is, so undergrads, masters, and PhD, all of them take this class. But for PhD students, sometimes 2-norm is not the right norm to look at, and you may want to look at other norms to measure convergence of an algorithm. So that is something which I won't really stress about in this class, but I will stress if you come back and do some research under me. Norm is very important. Okay, any other questions on this norm and distance or metric? Yes?
Is there a physical meaning for L infinity norm and L2 norm? Because L2 norm is somewhat, you know, in this 3D space, basically,
right.
Calculate distance is something like
correct.
L2 norm.
Correct. Let me not give you a mathematical answer. Let's say you are in. So where is L? So let me look at L1 norm, okay? So if you are, so let's look at a ball, a unit ball under each of these norms. So in L1 norm, a unit ball looks like this. This is a unit ball in L1 norm. This is the ball, which is actually a circle. This is an L2 ball. And this is an L infinity ball. Now these are the three different balls. So as you can see, the size of the ball changes depending upon which metric or which norm you are looking at. Now, when is L1 metric useful? Let's say you are in a city, and the city has roads that looks like this. Okay, so each of this white line is a road, and each of this point is an intersection. If you want to go from point A to point B, you can look at the Euclidean distance, which is this distance. This is the Euclidean distance. Is that useful? It's not, right? What you want to know is how much time it's going to take for you to go from A to B, and for that you have to look at the L1 norm. Okay, that will give you a useful measure of distance in this particular application. Okay, so depending on the application, the usefulness of norm changes. L infinity norm is not something that we will harp about in this class, but when you talk about reinforcement learning or when you talk about dynamic programming, which is something we will study, but I'm really talking about dynamic programming in MDP setting where you do an infinite horizon dynamic program, which is not something that we'll study in this class. Then you use L infinity norm for measuring whether you are converging or not. Okay? So you don't use L2 norm, you don't use L1 norm, you use L infinity norm to measure convergence of your algorithm in infinite horizon dynamic program. Okay? But we'll not talk about it in this class. I have another course on reinforcement learning, which was recorded, I think last year in spring, 2020 spring, and those videos are available online. And in the entire class, I only talk about infinity norm, because that's the usual notion of convergence in infinite horizon dynamic programs.
Was there a question?
No?
Yes.
All
the LP norms will be between L1 and L1, or?
Oh yeah, that's a good point. So P, infinity is also included. Yeah. P has to be between 1 and infinity. Well, let's not include infinity in the LP norm. X infinity is defined in this way, which is actually a limit of LP norm as P goes to infinity.
Even when we visualize, that is true?
Sorry?
Even if we visualize, that's the way we visualize it on the graph, on the right side.
Yes? Yeah, so LP norm would look like this.
I mean, it all will the region between this.
Sorry?
All the regions,
yes,
within the square, but outside.
Correct. So L1 ball is the smallest, and L2 ball is the slightly larger, and then LP ball will be larger than that if P is higher than 2, and then L infinity ball is the entire square. That's right. Any other question? Yes.
What exactly do you mean by ball?
Ball means, what's a ball? Ball is the set of all vectors when the norm of x is equal to 1. This is a unit ball. Position. And this is, of course, an n-dimensional vector. So EI lies in I. So I pick a vector in Rn where all the elements are 0 except the element at the ith position, which is equal to 1. Then I can write x, any vector x can be written as summation of xi ei, I equals to 1 to n. And remember that xi is actually a scalar. It's not really a vector. Xi is a scalar, x is a vector. So I can write any vector x by multiplying ei with xi and summing it all up. And therefore, e1 to en are called standard bases. Okay, so we have the standard bases in Rn. You might also recognize that EI transpose EJ is equal to 0 for I not equal to J, and EI transpose EI is equal to 1 for all I. What that means, what it means to say that these are orthonormal bases is, of course, they are unit vectors, they are orthogonal to each other, and any vector x can be written as alpha I vi, I equals 1 to n, that alpha is appropriate weight. It could be positive, it could be negative, alpha is not in R. And any vector x can be decomposed into the individual components along each of these orthonormal basis vectors. Can someone tell me how can I compute alpha I? So if I know the vector x and I have a set of orthonormal basis v1 to vn, how do I compute alpha I here?
You calculate the length of the projection of your vector onto the I.
That's right. So alpha is essentially the projection of x onto vi. How do I compute that?
With a cross product?
With a cross product. Well,
cross product divided by
inner product, yeah.
What is that? Or sorry, dot product.
Well, yeah, dot product, yeah. Alpha I equals to x transpose vi. Oh. So by taking the inner product or a dot product between x and vi, we get the value of alpha. If you don't have an orthonormal basis, things are a bit more complicated. To get the values of alpha I, you have to do a little bit more work. You have to do some matrix inversions. But if they are orthonormal basis, there's no matrix inverse or anything, just a simple inner product will do the job. Okay. Let's think about why orthonormal basis would be useful for optimization. Okay? So I know that this is something that you may not have thought about. Let me tell you why this line of thinking is useful. So I have a Euclidean space. I'm running some optimization algorithm in this space. Depending on the curvature of the function that I'm trying to optimize, I can come up with an orthonormal basis within that space. And it turns out that when you're doing the running the optimization algorithm, the convergence to the optimal solution is different along each of these orthonormal bases. Okay? So along some dimensions, along some orthonormal bases, the convergence is slow. Along some other direction, the convergence is very fast. Okay? So we will talk about that when we get into Newton's method and all that. But that's something you keep in mind. That's why orthonormal bases is important. Because you can divide the space into these different directions, different basis function, and you can study the speed of convergence of the optimization algorithm along all of these different basis functions. Of course, usually we always look at if you look at the vector, you're actually looking at the vector from a regular basis, not from the orthonormal basis view, which is why you might say that, oh, the convergence is not happening, but it could be the case that the convergence has already happened along some orthonormal basis, and it's only along the slower orthonormal basis direction along which the convergence is not happening. And that has to do with how the function, what the curvature of the function looks like along those basis directions. So when I run my optimization algorithm, I get x0, x1, x2, x3, so on. It's a sequence. From a sequence, I can extract a subsequence. I can define xkn, n equals to 1 to infinity, which is a subset of the original sequence. And this is known as a subsequence. Now we know why sequences are important in optimization. The output of MATLAB is actually a sequence. So what is it that we worry about in optimization? We worry about convergence of the sequence. So we want to know when does a sequence converge. So let's talk a little bit about convergent sequences. Sequence xk, k going from 1 to infinity. So xk converges to x bar if and only if for every epsilon greater than 0 there exists an epsilon which is a natural number such that xk minus x bar some norm, whatever norm, whatever is the favorite norm, you can pick it, is less than epsilon for all k greater than equal to n epsilon. This is my xk. Do you think the sequence converges? Looks like it's a convergent sequence. Let me draw this line next bar. This is my next bar. So the reason why this is a convergent subsequence, convergent sequence, is because if I look at x bar, I have this x bar, and I pick any epsilon greater than 0, which is my x bar plus epsilon. This is my x bar minus epsilon. And so if I look at this limit, x bar plus epsilon and x bar minus epsilon, there is always a k which depends on, there is always an n epsilon which depends on epsilon. So if I pick a smaller value of epsilon, my n epsilon is going to be very large. If I pick a larger value of epsilon, my n epsilon is going to be small. But for every epsilon greater than 0, I can find an n epsilon such that the entire sequence is within this ball. I mean, not a ball, but, well, yeah, it is a ball, actually. It's a ball of radius epsilon centered at x bar. So you can find the entire tail of the sequence will be within that ball. Okay. So this is the tail of the sequence, xk for k greater than n epsilon, that's the tail of the sequence. The entire tail is actually within the epsilon ball of x bar. And that's what it means for the sequence to be converted. Any questions on the convergent sequence? As I mentioned, we always worry about convergence in optimization. Is this a useful definition for convergence? Can we, if I'm looking at the output of an optimization algorithm, will I be able to check this condition? Not really, right? Because we are only going to run the algorithm for maybe 1,000 steps, so I only know x1 to x1,000. I don't quite know what x bar is. And I will probably never be able to compute x bar because I don't have the luxury of running my algorithm for infinite number of time steps, which is what this mathematical definition seems to suggest. So this is not a very useful definition, but it is the ultimate mathematical definition for convergence. So therefore, we talk about a specific class of sequences which are known as Cauchy sequences. So Cauchy sequence satisfies the following property: xk is Cauchy if and only if for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists n epsilon in n such that xk minus xk plus n is less than epsilon for all k greater than or equal to n epsilon. Oh, n is a natural number. That's a Cauchy sequence. And the theorem is Cauchy sequence converges. And the proof sequences, what we actually can check. Of course, we can't check it for all n, but what we do check when we are running an optimization algorithm is we look at the difference between the successive numbers, and we look at the difference between, let's say, 4 or 5 steps. And if all of them are small, 10 raised to minus 4, 10 raised to minus 5, we kind of say, okay, fine, we are converged. Let's just move on with our life. Okay, so Cauchy sequence is a very important concept It's easy to check in optimization algorithm. Of course, we don't check it for all n natural numbers, but we just check it for n equals 1 to 5. And as long as it's small, we kind of quit the optimization solver. And one of the reasons why we can always do that is because the Cauchy sequence always converges in Rn. Okay? So with that, I'm going to end the class here. We are already above time. And we'll go over some of the other properties of continuous functions and so on in the next class. Thank you for your attention.
Okay.